I've seen a strange thing. A man will be convicted of his sin. He will repent. And then it seems quickly that man will go and leap into another witch's brew. I've been puzzled by this. A young man that I've been working with, who's been caught in lust and fornication, I've been speaking with him about the issues of his wickedness. I've confronted him with his sin. I've done all in my power via the prayer closet, crying out to God for this young man. And then he's convicted of his sin. He turns from it and immediately jumps into pride and arrogance, argumentativeness. Which is worse, pride and argumentativeness or fornication? How would Jesus judge? They're both equally destructive before the kingdom of God. I praise God for a man who will turn from his sin, but I've been saying, oh God, could a man turn from his sin and just worship you? Could a man turn from darkness and just give himself to you and not leap into another wickedness? A man stops smoking cigarettes. Quickly, the Lord gives him full victory, only to have him leap into pornography. My dad used to say something strange. We would go out and do Bible studies. We had films and tapes, and we would go into homes where we'd been invited, and they would gather the neighbors together, and we would do a Bible study. A series of Bible studies. And we would come to that series with open hearts. Dad was very well versed in the scriptures. And finally, he would come to that part of the Bible study series that dealt with a man being crucified, with a man totally giving up his life and surrendering to Jesus Christ. And as we would go to the meeting, my father would say to me, Raymond, you're going to see something strange tonight. You're going to see men who will be dug out from behind one stump, and quickly they'll run and hide behind another stump. He said, we've brought the dynamite tonight to blow them out of one hole, but they'll just go climb in another hole. He said, very few men and women will finally just be crucified with Christ. Very few men or women will honestly choose to follow after Jesus. I have found that to be true. And one of the great concerns, as I was speaking with a friend about this morning, he said to me, one of the reasons people jump from one sin to another and continue in their wickedness is that they don't have a church family where they are held accountable. They don't have a church family where they are taught the beauty of simply surrendering all that they have and all that they are, being crucified with Christ. You can convince a man perhaps to leave one area of sin because he's sick of it and he sees that it is bringing him a disadvantage. And so in his flesh, he is willing to cast off that one area of sin so that he can leap over here and continue to walk in the flesh. But he's not walking in the same sin, and so he thinks of himself as improved. I have one young man who's always saying to me, Pastor, is God pleased with me? Am I making progress? Will God do for me what I'm asking? And I try to explain to him time after time, you can't search after Jesus so that he will do what you want him to do. There were disciples who followed Jesus for the loaves and the fishes. They wanted the food, the physical food. They wanted the miracles. And Jesus spoke to them and said, look, you're going to have to eat my flesh. My flesh is real food. My blood is real drink. Now, he's not speaking about cannibalism. He's speaking about a spiritual truth. That we don't serve Jesus in order to get something. We serve Jesus so that we could give ourselves totally and completely to him. And so if you find yourself ducking behind this stump and that stump, know that you are still walking in your flesh. That by its very nature, a crucifixion means you're spread wide and high. You have no defense left. This morning, as I awakened from my sleep, there were tears in my eyes. I went back in my mind and I thought about some events that have transpired in my life. I thought about how dishonest I'd been. I thought about how I had escaped the snare by not being honest. Not telling a lie, per se, but just not telling the whole truth. And, frankly, that is a lie. By not telling the whole truth, I lied. And there was just a great sorrow in my heart, for no longer do I desire to jump behind a stump and hide from Jesus. You remember in the Garden of Eden, the Lord came walking in the garden in the cool of the day to meet with his prospective bride, Adam and Eve. And they were nowhere to be seen. And so God called to them, where are you? Adam, where are you? And Adam answers, he's hiding in the bushes because he's naked and he's ashamed. It's always the Lord God of heaven who comes searching after us. He exposes our sin. He reminds us of things in the past that are yet undealt with, not dealt with, not cleaned up, not put under the blood. He doesn't want us to run and hide from him again. He wants us to stand in our nakedness before him. And he will clothe us. He will make us righteous. He will put his arms about us. If we simply go duck into another cave where we think we can be right, if we just go hide behind another stump to hide our nakedness, what have we accomplished? Nothing. Each day I come on the radio and I ask you, what progress are you making toward the celestial city? One of the signs that you're making great progress is that you no longer hide your wickedness. Instead, you weep and you confess, and you plead with Jesus to wash you and make you clean. And when he does, you don't dive into another mud puddle. You don't jump into some other place of wickedness. You just stay before him and let him wash you, cleanse you. It reminds me do you remember we spoke earlier in this week about the different kinds of seed, different kinds of soil? The seed is the same, it's the Word of God. but different kinds of soil. Remember the choking Christian? The worries of this life, the love of pleasure, the love of riches, of stuff, rises up and chokes out the word. But there is a fourth kind of soil, and it's the soil that is good soil. And the word of God is planted in that soil. And it's very interesting. It says, by persistence, by persistence, a harvest, a hundredfold, is produced. Well, what is that persistence being spoken of? It is being willing to be naked before God. It's willing to simply wait upon Him as He dresses us in the robes of righteousness. It's being willing to endure the job you hate, or the marriage that's painful, or whatever else is piercing your heart. It's the piercings that cause the root to go down deep into the soil. It's that piercing, that anguish, that pain that causes us to put our trust in Jesus Christ and grow in Him. One person that I spoke with said, "Pastor, you mean if I become a Christian, I'm going to undergo suffering?" I said, "Absolutely." "Well, then why would I want to become a Christian?" "Well," I said, "you can perhaps have your heaven here and avoid most of the suffering, and then you're thrown into hell, and there you will suffer for your sins. But most people, they still suffer even though they're walking in their sin. They still suffer. In some ways, they suffer more than a Christian. But a person who's called by Jesus will be tested by Him. The Lord will discipline him," Hebrews, the 12th chapter. The Lord will discipline that person who says, "I will follow Jesus." He will even administer corporal punishment, whippings. Following Jesus is not just a pleasant hobby that we might follow. Following Jesus requires a full court press. It requires full energy. It requires full attention. It will take every ounce of energy you have to be saved. And if you don't expend that energy, if you don't seek after Jesus, if you don't allow Him to bring the testings into your life, if you don't allow Him to bring the sufferings and you turn in grief and anger and bitterness against Him, you will surely be lost. I have undergone such bitter testings, losing everything I had financially, losing my savings and a house and a job, having my family turn against me because I was following Jesus and they said I was a fanatic, struggling month by month with the work of the gospel, barely able to keep my head above water, either physically or spiritually or financially, never knowing from one day to the next whether there would be food to eat. I remember when the Lord called my wife and I to come to Woodbridge, we went to the Days Inn, and they assigned us room 911 for an extended stay. There were nights when I had to stay up all night and pray that I would have the money to pay for the hotel bill for the morning, as we simply spent our time in that hotel room praying for revival in Washington and praying for the National Prayer Chapel to be birthed, praying for the money to begin broadcasting on radio. Never forget the first time I went on radio here in Washington. It was at another station. In fact, it was this station, but it was under different ownership. And I went to the manager and I asked him if I could broadcast a Christian broadcast on his station, half hour a day. We talked a bit and he wanted to know the story and background, and I shared that with him. Wanted to know who my pastor was, and I told him Pastor David Wilkerson, Times Square Church. We continued to talk and share, and finally he said to me, "Well, Pastor, you know, this is a for-profit business. Do you have the money?" And I said, "No, I don't have the money." He sat back in his chair and he smiled and he said, "Pastor, when you have the money, come back and see me." So I went back to room 911 and prayed. My mother was having a surgery, and so we drove to Holy Cross Hospital over in Maryland where the surgery was going to be held. And just before we got to Holy Cross, a car ran a red light and hit us. We discovered it was a woman who was also on her way to Holy Cross for cataract surgery on both eyes. She was almost as blind as a bat. None of us were hurt. We took her insurance information. We went on to the hospital. My car was still drivable, although ugly. That night, as I was kneeling in prayer and thanking the Lord for his mercy in not letting us be hurt or this woman to be hurt in the accident, he said to me, "Don't repair the car, use that for radio." Well, I had no idea how much money would be coming. I took it to the insurance adjuster. They told me that the car was totaled because it was an old car. And they gave me a check. Well, I bought the car from the insurance company for a very small sum of that check. And what was left, I took immediately to the radio station and sat down with the manager. And I said, "I have the money. How much are you going to charge me?" Well, it was exactly the amount of money I had. He said, "Well, Pastor, how much money do you have?" I said, "I have enough for 1 month." He said, "Pastor, you can't go on the air with enough money just to pay for 1 month. At the end of the month, you'll be out, and I'll have to pull you from the air, and the ministry will be shamed." I said, "No, the Lord said to go on the air with 1 month. That's what he said." He said, "Well, I'll take your money, but you're only going to be on this radio station for 1 month." I'll never forget the grace of God as toward the end of that month, as we cried out to the Lord, one of the listeners came to me and said, "Pastor, I have a lot of tools in my basement. My husband passed. Would you be willing to come and take them and do a yard sale and keep the money for radio?" I said, "Yes, I'd be happy to do that." And so we held a yard sale with those tools, that bandsaw, and all the other things, and that was enough money to pay for the second month of radio. Well, that month, a dear woman called. She said, "Pastor, I have a sewing machine that I'd like to donate." And I said to myself, "Lord, a sewing machine? What's that going to bring? $50? Lord, you see the need." At that point in our ministry, we were having to pay the hotel bill every month. We had no congregation. Everything had to come by faith. We went to her house and we picked up her sewing machine and discovered it was a very valuable machine. We took it to a sew and vac place. They looked at it and they said, "Well, we have a lady who'd like to buy this." And it was for the exact amount of that next month's radio bill. Many times in the hotel, we'd be crying out to the Lord for the money to pay. I'd pray most of the night, and then the Holy Spirit would say to me, "Okay, go to bed. It's covered." And the next morning, I would go out, and the clerk at the desk would say to me, "Pastor Ray, your bill has been paid for the next week." "Well, who paid it? Could I see?" "No, they paid cash." And the Lord had covered. Often the only food we had was graham crackers and milk because the hotel served those free. That was our dinner many nights. And then as I continued to walk with the Lord, He continued to test me. The Lord provided a home for us. And for the next 10 years, I didn't pay the rent. Brother David Wilkerson in Times Square Church paid the rent as a gift to the ministry. I've seen the testings come, and they've been such bitter testings at times, and then I've seen the deliverance of God come in such power. The Lord said to me many years ago, "Will you receive from my hand only what I choose to give you?" And when I said yes, I didn't understand that I was also saying, "Yes, I'll take whatever tests you need to apply to my life. Whatever discipline you need to apply, I'll receive it." And then the hardest test of all, when my wife grew sick and died of cancer in May of 2010. What a bitter, bitter test that was for my heart. And yet what joy and peace in my soul, because I know she's in a better place, and I could not wish her back. She finished her course with a shout of praise to Jesus. But still, what a bitter test to my soul. Has God deserted me? Has He left me? No, He said, "I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you." And through those dark nights, those times of weeping before Him in sorrow for my loss, praising Him for His gain, but weeping for my loss, the Lord's comfort always came, and He always carried me in His arms. I hope you hear what I'm saying to you today. Don't run from one stump to another, accusing God of this, not receiving what He brings to you, being bitter and angry and jealous, being envious of another. Now open your heart wide. Receive from Jesus what He wants to give you. Many of you walk alone because you don't have a church that calls you to repent. You don't have a pastor who teaches you to say no to ungodliness. You don't have a place that is honest in fellowship. Many of you are in churches where every casual thing is spoken of. Every football game is discussed. Every baseball, it's just worldly conversation. It's not about Jesus. We need to talk about Jesus. When we come together socially, we need to talk about Jesus. We need to pray together. We need to encourage one another not to walk in unrighteousness, not to walk hiding from the Lord, but to open our hearts wide, to let Him see everything in our hearts. to let him know us. You know, it's impossible for a wife not to know her husband, and for a husband not to know his wife. If they don't know each other, they become just empty roommates, and soon there's nothing left between them, and they go their separate ways. Well, information about Jesus will not help you. You need to know Jesus, and Jesus needs to know you. And that means you're going to have to open your heart wide to him. You're going to have to let him see everything that stirs in your heart. You're going to have to ask him to break the power of every word of Satan that is spoken into your soul. You're going to have to ask him to encourage you and comfort your heart. It's very important that you understand today. Jesus has done everything in his power to dig you out of the morass of sin. Every blessing of heaven in Ephesians, the first chapter, has been poured out from heaven. Nothing has been withheld by God for you. Everything has been given to you necessary for godliness and righteousness. Nothing has been withheld. But have you withheld from him? Are you withholding right now from Jesus? Are you withholding because you're angry with him? Yes, some of you are very angry with God. You're angry about your circumstances. You're angry about the lack of money. You're angry about the spouse you have. You're angry about how your children are behaving. You're angry, angry, angry. You can never know Jesus in your anger. You have to come and confess that anger. You'll have to let the Holy Spirit uncover the fullness of that anger. Hear my heart today. I used to be a very angry man. I was angry because my dreams were not being fulfilled. I was being blocked by circumstances. I now know it was God who was blocking my way. See, there is a gate at the sheepfold. And a gate can only be entered into when it's open, and when it's closed, it's a wall. I was angry that God was walling me out of his throne room. I'd pray and nothing would happen. I'd cry out to God and nothing would happen. He wanted me to confess to the depths of my soul every speck of anger and bitterness. That root of bitterness had to be utterly removed from my heart. And I don't want to say this. I have to. The root of bitterness can only be removed from your heart by suffering. I wish there were another way. I wish I could tell you today, look, take these 2 or 3 easy steps, and the bitterness will all disappear. No, it won't. Bitterness has to be put into the fire and burned out of our hearts, and it only comes by suffering. Anger only comes out by suffering, and you would think, well, suffering's going to make me angrier. No, it's not. Suffering will burn that anger in your heart out. It will humble your heart before God. It'll cause you to be small in your own eyes. It'll cause you to see that all of your righteous information is without value if in your heart there's bitterness and anger. jealousy, envy, lust. These things are only brought out of the heart of a man by testings, by suffering. Suffering is a key part of becoming righteous. I wish this were not true. I wish I could tell you that something else would work, but it won't. Only suffering washes the heart of a man and causes him to walk righteous before a holy God. I have suffered. I've been tested to the depths. And I praise God that in that process, He utterly removed the root of bitterness from my heart so that I cannot even find it anymore. It is gone. Is it gone from your heart? Are you still hiding from God? Are you still playing with sin? Pretending that everything's fine, but in the innermost part of your being, you know, you can't lie to yourself. Has the gentleness of God come and inhabited your heart? Do you know that you know that you know that Jesus loves you? And you have allowed Him to come into the very worst part of your soul and cleanse and heal and wash and restore. Our number in studio is 877-534-0780. Are you still an angry man? Are you still an angry person? Do you need Jesus? If so, call, please, right now. I'd be happy to talk with you about Jesus. I hope you hear my heart today. Some of you think, oh, Pastor Ray's a hard man. You know what? I'm not a hard man. I have a very soft and tender heart toward Jesus and toward all sinners, and especially toward those who are walking righteous before God. I just have no patience for the enemy anymore. I have no patience for people continuing to hide from God. I have no patience for people who are continually running after the lust of their flesh. But oh, my heart breaks for you. The blood of Jesus breaks the power of sin in your life. Are you willing to let Jesus come and wash you and scrub you and make you clean, to do the surgery in your life necessary to remove that bitter heart, that angry spirit? Are you willing to let Jesus have His way in your life, regardless of the pain it might cause you, the surgery without anesthesia that He will do in your soul? Are you willing to let Jesus change your heart and redeem your life? Our phone number is 877-534-0780. I want to read a scripture for you. It's found in Matthew. Matthew, the 17th chapter. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before Him. Lord, have mercy on my son, he said. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. You unbelieving and perverse generation, Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy, and he was healed at that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and said, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, because you have so little faith. Truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. I'm caught on verse 17. Jesus says to his disciples, you unbelieving and perverse generation. That word perverse in the Greek literally means twisted. Twisted, not straight. Someone who is clean with Jesus is straight, not twisted. That's where we get the word perversion from, this Greek word, meaning something twisted, something unclean. Jesus is saying to his disciples, you are still unbelieving and twisted and perverse and unclean. That's why you couldn't cast this demon out. Then they come and they ask him, and he says, because you have so little faith. What is faith? Faith is fidelity to Jesus. Faith is absolutely being convinced and adhering to Jesus. He's saying, your connection with me is still so weak that you cannot cast the demons out. He's saying, you do not have authority over the demons because you are still walking in league with darkness. These were the disciples of Jesus. Are you still walking in league with the devil? This story challenges all of us. For which of us could have cast that demon out? I don't know. I have not been tried in this area. I've been tried in my own life with demons coming to torment me, and when I commanded them to leave, they departed. But I've never prayed for another man who was fully possessed by a demon. So I have not been tested in this manner yet. But I am very clear. Jesus was saying to his disciples, you're perverted, you're twisted, you're still bound up with the devil, you're still walking in unbelief in relationship to me. Their time of testing was coming. Already they were enduring suffering. Their families, like Peter's wife, he had left her with the family. Peter and John had left the family business. They were following Jesus around the countryside. They were walking with Jesus. They were not doing their fishing business. They were suffering financially. They were being tested. Will you leave everything behind and follow me? And they did. They passed the test, but not without suffering. And then came the crucifixion. What immense suffering Jesus endured on that cross. But please just stay with me a moment. What suffering the disciples endured as their master was crucified and all of their dreams and hopes vanished in thin air. Have we been deceived? Was this man not God? Was this man not the Messiah? Oh, how they suffered in their heart, and how Peter suffered with his denial of Jesus, weeping, this strong, powerful man, weeping before God. He suffered. The resurrection. Remember, they were around that fire with Jesus. They'd gone out fishing, and Jesus came and prepared breakfast for them on the beach. And they came in, they saw that it was Jesus. And Jesus turned to Peter and he said, "Lovest thou me more than these?" Well, what were the these? I don't know. I wonder, was he talking about the fish? "Do you love me more than these fish, Peter? You've gone back to fishing. I called you to be a fisher of men. And instead of being a fisher of men, you're out fishing again in the lake. Do you love me more than these fish? Do you love me more than making money, Peter?" "Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, I love you." Again, the question comes, "Peter, do you love me?" "Yes. You know I love you. Feed my sheep. Not catch fish. Feed my sheep." And again, a third time, he said, "Peter, do you love me?" Hurt now, a feeling. "Yes, Jesus, you know I love you. Feed my lambs." "Don't go fishing, Peter. Feed my lambs. Take care of the church. Take care of the church, Peter. Sacrifice your life for the church." Then Peter sees John walking and he said, "What about him?" Jesus said, "It's none of your business. Just follow thou me." The only command we have is to follow Jesus. To take care of the church. It's the body of Christ. Where's your heart today? Are you taken up with your own agenda? Are you out hiding behind this stump and that stump, arguing this and arguing that, proving you're right here and there, walking in legalism, walking in anger, walking in bitterness, walking in worldliness, walking in the lust of the flesh? Or are you following Jesus? And are you feeding his sheep? How do you stand today? We're almost out of time. If you'd like to call, you're welcome. I'd take one phone call quickly. If you're under deep conviction, I'd love to pray for you. 877-534-0780. And while I'm waiting on you, I'm going to give you some information. I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. This broadcast belongs to Jesus. It's sponsored by Jesus. It's here to feed his sheep, to feed his lambs. And if you're called to give, to feed the sheep of God, if you're called to bring the food into the warehouse so that it can be fed to God's people, then I'd like to hear from you. And by the way, I'm so grateful for those of you who've begun sending your tithes and offerings, because this is the place where you're taught righteousness, and so you're giving. Some of you have local churches that you belong to where you're being taught, and I praise God for those local churches and those local pastors, but some of you don't have that place, or if you do, you go to an ungodly church. It's a social deal. I praise God that you're responding and giving. That will enable me to continue proclaiming the Word of God in this city. Write to me at the National Prayer Chapel. That's the National Prayer Chapel. Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Again, it's the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. I also welcome you to come and worship with us. We'd love to have you visit. We meet at the All Saints Church. It's an Anglican church. It's a brand new facility located on Gideon Drive. That's Gideon, like the Bible character, the hero of faith. It's at 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22192. That address again, 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia. It's right next to the Hilton Memorial Chapel. As you come down Gideon, you'll pass the chapel on your left, and immediately you will see the large white church, a new church. Drive into the parking lot, go around all the way to the back side, and there you'll see double glass doors, and there'll be a large white sign that will say Lower Lobby. Come in those double glass doors, and immediately on the left-hand side will be the National Prayer Chapel Worship Center. If your heart is being called, come quickly. Now, I also want to invite you to go to our webpage. It's nationalprayerchapel.com. Nationalprayerchapel.com. I also want to give you my personal cell number. Some of you have needed to just talk and pray off air because there are things that were private that you didn't want to say on the air. It's my private cell number is 703-489-1785. That's 703-489-1785. And some of you have said to me, Pastor, how can you give your private number? Well, everything I have is given to saving the souls of men. I don't need a private number. I need to talk with men and women who want to get right with Jesus. That's the cry of my heart. My personal life is given to Jesus. So if you need to call, call me. We'll talk and we'll pray. Now let me pray for you before this broadcast ends. Mighty God, our Father, I'm asking today that your royal authority would be exercised over every person who has listened to this broadcast. I know you have convicted many hearts today, and you are turning them toward heaven. Lord, I pray today that every man and woman who is still hiding out behind some false argument, and every man and woman who is still caught in bitterness and rage, who's still caught in envy or lust, Lord, I pray now that they will surrender and consecrate themselves to you, that they will lay on their face before you and weep over their sins and renounce their wicked ways and turn once more unto the way of holiness. Lord, I pray today for each who is listening that you would bring each person into the place they need to come in order to be delivered of all of their sin. to be made righteous. And Lord, I pray for each today who is undergoing that suffering. I pray you'll bring them forth like gold tried in the fire. I pray for the victory of your people today. I pray for your mercy today for each person who is undergoing the testing. I pray that you will give them the strength to endure and the courage to continue and not turn back. Lord, I pray that as they're crucified, you will stand up from your throne and shout for joy and bring them fully into your kingdom and give them your peace and your joy. Lord, meet the cry of every heart now as this broadcast comes to a close. Lord, meet the cry of their heart. Some are in desperate, desperate places. Jesus, you are their deliverer. Bring them forth. Establish them. Give them a place of standing in your kingdom, a place from which they can proclaim the name of Jesus. Lord, encourage my brothers and sisters today. Feed them, O mighty God, by your Holy Spirit, the precious broken body and spilled blood from Calvary's tree. Lord, I pray this in your mighty name. I ask for your mercy today. I ask for your kindness today. And Lord, those who are walking in victory, and I know that many listening to this broadcast have gained the victory in you and they no longer walk in sin. Oh Lord, they're still immature. They still have infirmities, but there's no more rebellion in their heart. Lord, I praise you for each precious person who has gained the victory by your blood. Lord, bless them today. Bless them. Open the windows of heaven and pour out such a blessing that they will not be able to contain it. Lord, lift them up from every circumstance in which they find themselves. Speak to them and guide their feet. Preordain their steps. Let your Holy Spirit rest upon them in great power. I pray in the precious name, the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. It would do my heart great good to see you on Sunday or to receive a letter from you this week. Know that God's blessing comes to those who will repent. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon. To keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory.